Good morning.
Good morning.
A special welcome. We have a few visitors here today, so a special welcome to them. Please join us for coffee hour immediately after the service. To get there, all you have to do is go out, turn left, and follow all the wonderful, nice people. We'll do coffee and something to eat as well. A couple of things. Sometimes here at St. Thomas, we get to know each other a little bit better, so I'd like you to turn, greet someone around you, and introduce yourself, and if you could, tell them the most fascinating place that you have ever visited. The most fascinating place you've ever visited. All right, talk amongst yourselves. Of you loudly, because we're all good friends. So let us stand. Your entire service can be found in your order of worship. Our opening to him is a familiar tune, but different words that more aptly fit the gospel. So hopefully you will recognize the tune and you will sing loudly. So please stand.
Thank you.
our head, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen. A reading from the book of Jeremiah. Thus says the Lord, cursed are those who trust in mere mortals and make mere flesh their strength, whose hearts turn away from the Lord. They shall be like a shrub in the desert and shall not see when relief comes. They shall live in the parched places of the wilderness, in an uninhabited salt land. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. They shall be like a tree planted by water, sending out its roots by the stream. It shall not fear when heat comes, and its leaves shall stay green. In the year of drought, it is not anxious, and it does not cease to bear fruit. The heart is devious above all else. It is perverse. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, test the mind and search the heart, to give to all according to their ways, according to the fruit of their doings. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Then he looked up at his disciples and said, Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely the reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Christ.
Take my lips and speak through them. Take our minds and think with them. Take our hearts and set them on fire with love for you. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Let me add my welcome to that of Alex, our priest. Please know how welcome you are here. And I just want to make it very clear, we love babies here, and so now the two of the babies that are here, I baptized. I know they're going to be quiet the entire time, but for the other babies, we love baby noises and even crying, so don't worry about that. Just know how glad we are to have you here. Now, Alex, when he invited me to preach, did what Alex always does. He's kind of polite, and he says, just remember, we need to be finished by 10:30. That is short for make it sweet and quick, right? Well, so it may be quick. I never know till I preach it. But I can guarantee you this will not be sweet. Today's lesson is one of the reasons we have a lectionary. It's a 3-year cycle. There is an appointed reading for every Sunday of the year. And one of the reasons for that is left to our own devices, there would be some parts of Scripture that we would never read and never read in church because they're just too difficult. Thomas Jefferson had what's known as the Jefferson Bible. He actually didn't believe Jesus was the Son of God, and so he just cut everything out of his Bible that seemed to indicate that Jesus was divine as well as human. The lectionary tries to keep us from being that way with Scripture. And so this is the day we have to look at this portion of Scripture. It's probably why Alex invited me to preach. So let's just remember what's happening here in this gospel. We're part of this story that's going on in Epiphany. Most of it happens during this season, although one part of it we read on the first Sunday of Lent. So you have Jesus is baptized in the Jordan, right, by John the Baptist. A voice says, "You are my beloved, and you I am well pleased." You would think that would be cause for great joy. If you heard that voice from heaven, you'd probably be pretty psyched about that. In fact, it it troubles Jesus so much that he is forced into the wilderness to figure out what in the world that means and what he's going to do with the gifts that he's been given. We know this as the temptations, and that's the piece that we will read on the first Sunday in Lent. Jesus comes out of the desert, out of the wilderness, and preaches his first sermon at his hometown synagogue, right? And everybody's kind of impressed with him. I mean, they've been hearing that he's up to some really great things, and they're kind of nudging each other and saying, ooh, that's Joseph's boy. Not too bad for a hometown boy. But then he moves to what in the South we call, you move from preaching to meddling. Right? Like, he moved from a welcome message to one that is quite confrontative. And that scene ends with the congregation of that synagogue trying to throw him off a cliff. Not exactly rave reviews for the hometown synagogue, right? And then Jesus calls the disciples, and then happens the Sermon on the Mount. This passage is not from the Sermon on the Mount. This passage is from the Sermon on the Level, the Sermon on the Plain. If you want the Sermon on the Mount, you need to read Matthew's Gospel. Remember, Matthew was writing for Jews. But today we're reading from Luke, and remember that Luke is the gospel about the outcast, because Luke himself was a Gentile. And so his whole gospel is about the place of the outcast in God's world. And what he has to say this morning, I mean, if you weren't disturbed by it, you really weren't paying attention, right? Because it turns everything that we tend to think on its ear. It literally turns it upside down. So what, and by the way, he's a lot rougher with us than Matthew is. Matthew talks about being poor in spirit. Matthew talks about being hungry and thirsty for righteousness. Luke just talks about being hungry and being poor, being reviled. I mean, there's no like spiritualizing this so it's easier to swallow. This is about the place of the outcast and the downtrodden in God's world. And that place is one of blessing. Now, I mean, think about that. So, blessing, you're blessed if you're poor, if you're hungry, if you're weeping, or if you are reviled by everyone. I mean, is that what you think of as a blessing? Who would want that? And woe to you. I mean, just Luke is like, he wants to make sure you haven't misperceived what Jesus is saying here. So he elucidates about woe to you if you are rich, full, laughing, and people speak well of you. Pretty much all the things that we pray for, right? So why is this all turned on its ear? Why is Jesus proclaiming a world that is completely, utterly counterintuitive? So here's the point. None of us want to be weeping. None of us want to be hungry. None of us want to be poor. But when you are more aware of your need of God than at any other time in your life. And most of us are pretty comfortable. We're not worried, for the most part, about where our next meal is going to come from. We know we've got bus fare or metro fare for tomorrow. Most of us have a job. Most of us have the means, the resources to make it pretty well in the world. And Jesus is pointing out the danger in that, because you kind of lose track of your need of God. you're kind of living as if you're doing this all yourself and I'm just fine, thank you very much. I'll go to church on Sunday, that'd be nice, but I don't really need it. And what Jesus is saying is, we all need it. And when we are in one of those extremely rough times, we are more apt to understand our need of God. And that's a good thing. In fact, that's a blessing. I remember in the early 90s, I went to Uganda to do AIDS work. And it was my first time in Africa. And I got off the plane in Entebbe, and on the drive in from Entebbe to Kampala, the capital, you know, pretty much everybody, if they were lucky, pretty much everybody lived in a corrugated metal, under a corrugated metal roof. Those who weren't that wealthy just didn't have a roof at all. As far as I could tell, nobody had anything of material wealth. And like any good colonialist person, I pitied them. Well, imagine my surprise when I discovered them to be amongst the most happy, the most contented, the most grateful, the most thankful people I have ever met on the face of the earth. And I couldn't imagine why. If you didn't show up an hour ahead of time for church, you stood outside and listened through the windows. And somehow these people, most of whom lived with a dirt floor, showed up in pristine white dresses and crisp white shirts on the men. And when they worshiped, it was as if they were blessed. And they were thanking God for all of God's many blessings. And as far as I could tell, they didn't have any of what you and I hope for. And in fact, what most of us have. But they understood their need of God. Because without God, life sometimes would be unbearable. And in an odd sort of way, they were blessed by that. Well, Who would be like that today? You know, it has to be refugees and immigrants, right? Those seeking asylum? Well, I was in El Salvador a couple of years ago and sat with a mother whose son, who was 15 years old, they tried to recruit into one of the gangs. In El Salvador, the government exists to protect the 10 or 12 wealthiest families, and the gangs run everything else. And this young mother was so proud of her son for resisting the gang, until the gang captured all of them, raped this young man's sister in front of him and his mother, and then killed him. And what she wanted to know from us, Americans, was, why shouldn't I have sent them north to your border? And we didn't have an answer other than we would have done the same thing. So here's the dilemma that is presented to us by Luke's account of this Sermon on the Level, where Jesus levels with us. It's a sermon on the plain. Jesus is speaking quite plainly here that if you want to know God and be blessed by knowing God, you need to move ever more towards that place of what we would call need and what God would call blessing. In Alcoholics Anonymous, we define humility as being right-sized, right? It's not, humility is not about claiming to be worse off than you are. It's about seeing yourself in rightful proportion to the rest of the world. And what Jesus, I think, is saying here, both in the woes and in the blessings, is that the more we are aware of our need of God, the more blessed we will be. And the more we listen to all those people who tell us we are wonderful when we're not especially, the more woeful will our lives be. Now, you may think that with the immigration and refugee thing, I'm getting a little bit political. That would be correct. Because it seems to me that the opposite of being thankful, the opposite of being blessed because you know your need of God, is being narcissistic. I mean, isn't that the antithesis of understanding how you are in relation to the rest of the world? And lest we judge someone else to be narcissistic, let's just own up to our natural proclivity to that as well. This notion that we're doing just fine and we're doing it all ourselves, ultimately is a woeful place to be. So let me just remind you that Jesus died a political death. Jesus was not crucified for saying, love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus was crucified because he presented a threat to the powers that be, and the Roman government killed him for that. It was a political death. He wasn't killed for his religious beliefs. He was killed because his religious beliefs challenged the status quo. And he was reviled for it. And if you and I challenge the status quo, we will be reviled for it too. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, look at the crap she's getting, right? What, because she thinks we should all have health care? Because income inequality is a bad thing? So what we're assured of in this gospel is that if we stand up for the things that God would stand up for, we are going to take a lot of crap for it. And we will be blessed. It's not a pretty message, but it's the one that Jesus is communicating to us today. I don't have an answer to it. I don't want to be all those things that are described as being blessed, but I do know that the more I move in that direction, the more blessed I understand myself to be. So I think we've been warned, right? Don't say nobody ever told you. We've been warned with Jesus leveling with us with plain talk. And all that's left to us is to ask the questions, do we want to come here on a Sunday morning and just listen to Jesus' words, or do we want to be transformed? Do we want to just sit here and admire Jesus? Wasn't he a great guy? Or do we actually want to follow him? May you be blessed. Amen.
Amen.
True God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father,
through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism and forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Continue with the prayers of the people. I invite your prayers for the following people on our parish prayer list: for Kim, Peggy Ann, Kristen, Jen, Knapp family. For Fran, Jim, Dave, Stephanie, Danielle, Liz, Steve, Paula, Debbie, Viva, Javier, Katie, and Baby Marquez. Andrew Rutledge, our seminary student. And for the repose of the soul of Grace Crane. To God who welcomes all in love, let us pray for the good of the church and the concerns of those in need.
God of the prophets, God of Christ, we are reminded today that your blessings do not necessarily follow the logic of the world. The world believes that those who have the most money and possessions are blessed, but Jesus reminds us that it is the poor who are blessed, the poor in spirit and the materially poor as well. We pray for a more just world in which all have enough and none are left behind. O God, your kingdom come.
Your will be done.
Though we fear death and avoid its inevitable arrival, Jesus tells us that those who mourn are blessed. Help us to experience the truth of this mystery. Bring healing and wholeness to those who are sick in body, mind, or spirit, and comfort those of us who have lost loved ones. O God, your kingdom come.
Your will be done.
While people covet power, Jesus blesses the meek. Instruct us, O God, in the ways of humility. Help us to stand in solidarity with the oppressed and marginalized. Show us your presence in the faces of those the world forgets. O God, your kingdom come.
Your will be done.
We live in a world where people crave praise and desire to be liked by everyone. Jesus tells us that following him means people hate you and will exclude you, revile you, and defame you, unlike countless prophets who came before us. Give us courage to stand up for righteousness. Fill our hearts with love, overflowing with mercy. Make our hearts pure and give us a vision of your glory. O God, your kingdom come.
Your will be done.
In a society divided by race, gender, class, ideology, sexual orientation, and so many other labels we alone have created, remind us that we are created in your image, each of us a beautiful reflection of you, each of us your beloved child. Help us then to end our conflicts and wars. Help us to be agents of reconciliation. Give us eyes to see the ways you are changing the world in which we live. Give us ears to hear your call to join with you in this great transformation. O God, your kingdom come.
Your will be done.
God of every land and nation, you have created all people and dwell among us in Jesus Christ. Listen to the cries of those who pray to you today. Bring healing to all wounds. Make whole all that is broken. Speak truth to an illusion. Shed light on every darkness, that all creation will see your glory and know your Christ.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Yes.
Talk to you later.
So Bishop Robinson, in his sermon, talked about transformation. For those who are seeking a community that is about transformation, you have found a community that is about transformation. I would like to draw your attention to this page, whatever number this is, it's being hidden. This is our newest thing of what we're doing as far as membership, to go deeper, to be people of transformation. This is based on our presiding bishop's The Way of Love. He gave a little sermon at a royal wedding that went was kind of popular, and a way that he talked about love. And he used these things to talk about the way of love, how you live that out in the world. So we took that and we applied that to our own community. So this is what we expect of our members here at St. Thomas as we come together to be people of transformation. So I invite you to read that at your earliest convenience. And if you're seeking a community like that, to be a part of people like that who are working to change the status quo and to be the world that God has dreamed for us, please come join us. We are worshiping here at 9:30, but in a couple of weeks, before we know it, we are going to move to a beautiful new building. I come with props. Beautiful new building on the corner of 18th and Church. So we will once again return to the historic site that was set on fire in 1970. A little bit different than the original building, but same great people, same great church that will be there and seeking to live out who Jesus is on the corner of 18th and Church. In that lovely new building, there will be chairs. Now, this chair is the exact chair that will be. It'll be joined by 200 of his closest chair friends. The reality is, though, we need to pay for those. So we're a little bit behind on those. We have just about 100 chairs. We're about halfway there. So, again, if you know somebody who likes chairs, who has ever sat in a chair before, the bar is low. We invite you to give that. We will include your name in a book, recorded in history forever, and be a part, and we will have a chair. We also encourage you, for those who are members, to have a chair not only for you, but for new people who will come as well. They're $299. They're at cost. We're not making any money off of these. So they're wonderful. If you could do that, that would greatly be appreciated. The rest of your announcements are found in your prayer book. Somebody want to talk about small groups? Anybody talk about small? Jason, you want to talk?
Hello. On page 19, it goes a bit deeper into the small groups that St. Thomas Parish is going to become very soon. I think many oftentimes in sort of an urban parish, we are often surrounded by crowds, and yet at the same time, I think we can often feel perhaps lonely in our sort of seeking more faith. And perhaps kind of going through these circles. So I think this is an opportunity to sort of stop that circle and go deeper as members of the St. Thomas Parish community as we work to live out these practices for a Jesus-centered life. What does it mean to be a part of the Episcopal branch of the Jesus movement, as our presiding bishop so famously describes? We'll be meeting within people's homes, perhaps within people's workplaces, just getting to meet each other more. Whatever we bring to this is what we get out of it, so I do encourage you, please, to bring everything that you wish to these. There's information on how to get in touch with Jesse or Catherine, or even through our website, stthomasdc.org, on how to learn more about small groups formation. I'm very excited about this. I hope that you're excited about it as well.
Any other announcements? Those announcements can be found in your bulletin. We continue with the offering Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
God, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself, and when we
You in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and the Father of all. Jesus stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, Almighty God, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling Christ's death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in Christ. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. That the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through Jesus Christ, our Savior, by Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
us as great numbers,
your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
And you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of the body and blood. Send us now into the world of peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God,